integrated end-to-end business strategy, manufacturing, R&D, commercial and supply chain, all tuned in time. So ladies and gentlemen, our moderator for this panel discussion, please welcome on the stage Global Category Director, Contract Manufacturing Operations, GlaxoSmithKline Consumer Healthcare Private Limited. Please put your hands together for Mr. Rajeev Manvani. Welcome, sir. Good afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, with all that applause and the challenge clap, I think your applause is going to be much louder as we welcome our first panelist on the stage, Vice President and Head Supply Chain, Lava International Limited. Please put your hands together for Mr. Saurabh Raghuvanshi. Well, it's gotten louder. That's wonderful. Up next, our second panelist, Vice President, Head of Export Imports and Export Control and Customs, Siemens Limited, India. Please put your hands together for Mr. Pramod Sant. Good afternoon, sir. Welcome. Joining us on stage, Vice President and India Head of Supply Chain Management, Pfizer Limited. Please welcome Mr. Sudhir Mohan Bansal. Good afternoon. Welcome, sir. Joining us on stage, Executive Vice President, R&D and Supply Chain, Blue Star Limited. Please welcome with a loud round of applause, Mr. D.H. Roy. Good afternoon, sir. Also joining us, Group Business Head, Corporate and Commercial Banking, IndusInd Bank Limited. Please welcome Mr. Alok Kedia. Welcome, sir. Good afternoon. Please put your hands together as we welcome Mr. Ramakrishnan Subramanian, CGM, Product Placement Planning, Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited. Welcome. Also joining us, Head Supply Chain, Diageo India Private Limited, Mr. Hariharan Krishnan. Good afternoon. Welcome. Thank you for joining our panel. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome with a loud round of applause, Head Supply Chain Finished Vehicle Logistics, Mahindra and Mahindra Limited, Mr. Nitish Kuchal. Welcome, sir. Good afternoon. To take us through from now all the way for the next 60 minutes, ladies and gentlemen, we hand over to our moderator of the session, Mr. Rajeev Manvani, sir.
Thank you very much. So good afternoon, everyone. I know it's a graveyard shift. You've had a good lunch, but I can see there's still a lot of energy in the room. So we'll try and make this as engaging as possible. So I seek your attention. It's a privilege for all of us to be here. Collectively, this panel has more than 200 years of supply chain experience. So I think what we need to look at is how can you gain from some of the experience that we have to share, and at the same time, there's a lot of experience that you bring to the table, which can enrich us as well. So please feel free towards the end to ask questions. I was told it's 1 hour 15 minutes, so we'll try and see. The way we've structured is we'll go through a round of questions. Everybody will have their inputs, and we'll try and keep about 15 minutes towards the end for audience questions. And that's to be very honest, that's the most exciting part of it. So please participate fully. Please, my apologies, I'll be using the device, not because I'm going to do my WhatsApps, but just because I have some references and some data points which I may like to refer to in between. Now, clearly, we don't want to give here gyan, which I think all of us know a lot about, we share a lot about. What we're trying to do is we'll try to have examples from our organizations, examples during our careers where we've seen things happen. What really brings things to life is when we share what we've gone through and how we've seen supply chain develop and how are our organizations looking to improve that in the future. All of us know the challenges in supply chain, so I will not take time on that. But there was a survey done by KPMG and a management institute of more than 150 organizations to see that what is it that can be done. So these are real hard facts. What are organizations doing, and what was collectively came as to what are the top four priority areas. And The first thing, interestingly, was, you know, what is the topic of, you know, our panel discussion today? That the biggest area which can impact is where supply chain strategy is integrated with business strategy. Now, we've heard a lot about supply chain integration, end-to-end supply chain, plan, source, make, deliver. But clearly, the key enabler for supply chain to really become an enabler for overall business, growth and competitiveness is how can the strategy be integrated so that it's not seen as a cost center, but then it is hand in glove with the overall business. So that was the first key point. Another was an integrated supply chain in itself. So clearly you cannot talk about a business strategy when the supply chain itself is, you know, dysfunct or working in silos. So that was the second most, you know, important aspect that came. The third was how can all this be done in a manner that's customer centric. Now, we talk about consumers in today's world, but, you know, clearly we have to satisfy our customers and then the consumers, you know, can be satisfied. And the fourth was a lot of it needs to be, you know, focused towards building the infrastructure. Skill sets, people are important, but the basic is you should first need to have the infrastructure, and then, you know, it can be enabled by people. So these are the four basic tenets, and so it kind of, you know, re-emphasizes that it's time that supply chain starts looking as being a partner, and how can they enable the business as a whole to deliver what it has to deliver. Just supply chain doing what it's doing in its own, you know, silo doesn't really help. So I've got an esteemed panel. As you can, you've heard, we've got people from R&D, we've got Alok, who's finance. So clearly, the people whom we were joking about, you know, one person whom we cannot make angry in the panel is him, because, you know, they are the ones or the gatekeepers of all. We've got end-to-end supply chain expertise. We've got people who handle operations, logistics. So please feel free. They will try and bring their, you know, experience to you, and please feel free to interact the way, you know, you feel best. In fact, what I'll do is I'll start with Alok, and as I mentioned, he's currently handling supply chain finance from IndusInd Bank. So I would like to ask him, how does he think that supply chain financing can help a business deliver its long-term goals? Not only supply chain, but a business. How can a business deliver its long-term goals?
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah.
See, Rajiv, thanks for your introduction, and good afternoon, everyone. See, as you all know, I mean, supply chain for a business is very important. Okay, and supply chain will work in favor of the company only if the supply chain constituents are strong. And who are these constituents? I mean, primarily, these are the dealers and the suppliers of that company, right? So what supply chain finance does is to make them stronger financially. I mean, basically, we make the banks and the other lenders who are into supply chain finance, they provide this working capital finance to these constituents, which are primarily, as I said, lender, suppliers and dealers of that company. So how it helps the company as such? See, every company has a limited, let's say, appetite in terms of taking risk, in terms of giving credit to their dealers, right? I mean, let's say you are a company, you can only give as much credit to your dealer or whoever is your buyer, right? So what supply chain finance does is basically fund to these dealers. I'll talk about the suppliers also separately, to these dealers without putting the company into risk. So the whole risk is taken by the banks, okay, based on certain comforts given by the corporate or the company. And these comforts are not in the form of any guarantee or collateral or anything. It's just that, I mean, that the dealer is working with the company for a, let's say, certain period of time. The company has a comfort on its track record. Basis that comfort, the banks lend to these dealers purely basis that comfort itself, without taking any other collateral from the company. Now, what happens if you are transferring that risk to the bank? It reduces your own risk without and it helps you increase the your sales, because if more funds are made available to the dealer, he will be in a position to buy more of your products, right? So it reduces your working capital requirement as well, because you are not giving that credit to that dealer. Because your working capital is also reduced, it reduces your cost of working capital as well, right? Now, when we come to the supplier side, if your supplier is let's say well financed, okay, that supplier will be in the position to supply you in time. You will have a stable supplies in your hand, and reliability also. Again, what it does, the supply chain finance, the banks fund to the suppliers, basis the comfort that corporate will give the payment on due date, right, to the bank on the behalf of, against the purchases that were made. So how it helps the suppliers and the dealers? Typically, while a corporate will have many large dealers and suppliers who can get the funding on their own terms themselves only. They don't need any kind of support. But many of these dealers and suppliers are SMEs. See, typically in India, these dealers, small dealers and suppliers, don't get funding from the banks because of the obvious reasons. I mean, their balance sheet is not strong. They don't make their balance sheet strong because of the tax implications. And hence, I mean, the banks and other lenders are very reluctant to finance them until they are able to cough out collaterals, which unfortunately is generally not available to these suppliers and dealers. So how this supply chain finance helps them is to provide working capital funding at very, very cheap rates. That is one, because the comfort is coming here from the anchors. So banks also get comfortable and they're able to give cheaper rates. No collateral requirement, again, because of the same reason. And easy availability also. I mean, typically, if they go out in the market, they will not be able to get the funding, as I said earlier. But here, if the corporate gets into a arrangement with the bank or other lenders for getting their dealers and suppliers funded, I mean, and then we are able to, I mean, as a banker, we are able to reach out to all the dealers and suppliers very, very easily. And so the availability of the funding is also very, very easy. So this is how actually it helps the corporates. One more reason why supply chain finance helps the corporate is it becomes an off balance sheet funding for the corporate, right? So you're aware, I mean, getting loans is not very easy. And in fact, even if it's easy, many of the corporates I know, I mean, the larger ones, they don't want any loans on their books. Okay, so supply chain finance is another way of actually getting off balance sheet funding, whereby the what we do is actually we buy out the receivables. So buying out receivables from your books, actually you get the money, but it doesn't appear as loan or debt in your books. So that's how actually the supply chain finance actually helps the corporate as well as the dealers and suppliers.
Thanks a lot. So I think there are two very key points here. One is that the corporate or the business entity per se, not only supply chain, is able to, their exposure is limited. So they are able to then take risks more in the marketplace rather than on the capital or the funding part. So I think that's a very key point. How, we were trying to explore how does this, enable the corporate entity. So I think that's a very good point that you raised. Thanks for it. And I think that's a key which, most of us do experience. So thanks a lot for that perspective.
Just one point. So this whole this thing arrangement is initiated by the corporate itself. It's not that dealers and suppliers are coming on their own. It's completely driven by the corporate, and that's why actually, I mean, more and more corporates should actually go for this arrangement.
Yeah. So thank you for that. Now, interestingly, let's move. So that was finance perspective. Now let's see. We've got Roy here. He's got a very distinct experience. He's worked in supply chain. He's done a lot of R&D, responsible for new product development. So it brings a very interesting perspective to it. So I'd like to ask him, from your perspective, what is it that the corporate entity, the various functions like the manufacturing is part of supply chain, but the other, swim lanes of supply chain, the R&D and the commercial, what is it that they expect from supply chain in terms of what should be done more or less? What are the changes that they expect?
Sure, Ajit. Thanks for giving me the opportunity. And good afternoon, everybody. I work for Blue Star. Luckily, I've been working in the downstream for so many years of the value chain, and now I moved upstream. Now you'll be wondering what you want downstream and upstream. In our parlance, we call like manufacturing and distribution or logistics as a downstream, and R&D supply chain as upstream. Nothing to do with who is bigger or who is smaller, nothing to do with that. So having worked in manufacturing and logistics for so many years, I could understand the pain and the issues that come up when a new product comes or a new supply is developed or the costing or the margin and metal cost and new technology that is to adopt it has always been a challenge to us. So as when I moved to the supply chain part, the first thing I did is divided the supply chain into two verticals. The two verticals in my parlance I call it a sourcing vertical and the procurement vertical. Most of the supply chain of course would have both the functions, but I realized that the competency, the challenges for these two are a bit different. In the sense, sourcing would be more into strategic kind of decision or discussions they need to have, whereas procurement is more of a tactical kind of operation actually. So that's the first division I made in our supply chain functions. Now what is the role of these two verticals? I'll try and explain in brief. So basically, the sourcing would try and coordinate between with the R&D mainly. Why R&D? Because any new technology that has come up with the vendor or a supplier could be related to the cost reduction or value engineering processes, could be developing a new component or new supplier. So that's where they work together with the R&D at a very early stage of the product development. How it helps? It helps to bring in the vendor in quite early in the stage so that we can leverage the competency of the vendor that we have. It's not necessary that all the competency or skill lies with us only, particularly when you're developing or sourcing a component. There are a lot of knowledge, technology and competence lies with the vendor, and how do we leverage that? Now what happens, why I'm separating, because the procurement guy gets into it, is always in a mode, should we, how to ensure that the technology is there and the cost effectiveness comes. Procurement guy generally tends to ensure how he delivers the component or a product so that there is no shortage either in the manufacturing or in the supply chain. So he's more concerned about that, whereas a sourcing guy will have his own strategic way of looking at the things. He will go to a vendor which will have a long-term relation. His idea is to build relation with the vendor so that in the long run, through using various technology, through value engineering and the subsequently product cost or component cost can be reduced. At the same time, between R&D and supply chain, a target is given by the marketing, because they set a target, two kinds of target, when the product will be launched and what price they want the product. Now R&D obviously alone cannot work on or commit a target price to the sales unless he works with the sourcing team. So that's where the sourcing team comes into picture again, and where both R&D, so a team has been made between R&D and the supply chain, sourcing part of supply chain. Again within that, what do you call, subject matter experts are being developed so that A person and B person from R&D and supply chain can work together and get into more details about the technology and also about the processes that is being used so that the product as it is can come at a desired target price. At the same time, it also has helped in shortening the total development time. That's one part of the sourcing cell, of the sourcing vertical rather. The procurement vertical, of course, interacts more with the manufacturing and the sales in the sense that right from the intent, from the S&OP process, ensuring that the capacity of the factory is utilized, helping make versus buy decision, because there are certain infrastructure that we have, probably we may run out of capacity, or whether the vendor has got that defined capacity, the cooling investments, all those things are taken care of by the procurement cell. Procurement vertical works very closely again with the manufacturing for the day-to-day tactical part, at the same time with the salespeople to ensure that through the S&OP or through the indent, whatever order fulfillment is requirement and whatever the planning is to be done, and how the, because our particular being a, what you call a seasonal product, we need to build stocks also, because typically what will happen are off season and seasonal requirements almost three times. Obviously we cannot have a capacity of three times, because otherwise it becomes, as it is even today, it is underutilized during the off season time. So how the capacities can be built, how the stock can be built, at the same time how the inventory can be controlled. So again he works with the vendor, the same vendor the sourcing has developed, to ensure how vendor managed inventory can be done, how if it is import the bond, if it is kept in the bonding, when it is to be debonded to ensure that the minimum warehouse requirement is there, at the same time inventory is managed. How to plan the whole milk run on a day-to-day requirement. So those are the parts which has been taken care of by the procurement cell. Again, there is obviously a seamless or a baton holding between the sources between the sourcing vertical and the procurement vertical, because once the product or a component or a vendor is developed, he has to ensure that everything has been taken care for the procurement people to just order and ensure that the delivery takes place. If there is an issue with the process or the component which has not come out is not as per the quality, obviously procurement people would be struggling to cater to the requirement of the manufacturing. So sourcing cell has to ensure that the processes quality has been set. So he works also with the supplier quality team to ensure that the process are indeed set and it is in a situation that can be scaled up, because ultimately when the season comes, it has to be scaled up to almost 2 to 3 times. So the process has to be in such a way that the scaling up can easily be done, so that procurement people should not be struggling to get the supplies as desired by the manufacturing or by the sales, because we have a mix of component procurement where we manufacture and certain direct sales also where we have a contract manufacturing. So they will also interact with the contract manufacturing people to ensure that the supplies are maintained as per the requirement. Having said that, of course, there's always a huge fluctuation in the forecast and actual sale, more to do with the month-end billing, as typically most of the industries would be facing that problem. So they will work very closely with the contract manufacturing or in-house manufacturing and the salespeople to ensure that the month-end sales are appropriately maintained and we do not lose out any sales. So inventory management at the same time, month-end sales, that becomes very, very challenging. So you can imagine if a sourcing guy gets involved into that tactical thing or day-to-day thing, obviously he won't be able to add value to ensure that the product cost and the product quality is maintained the way it is desired. So I realize probably it's the right thing to split between the two so that they can focus on the individual core areas. And I also realize that the core competency of the people are different. Though being in the supply chain, I realize the sourcing sales people's competency and the procurement sales competency are quite different. And certain people are good in chasing and ensuring that the material is available. They may not be as good in ensuring the process of control or getting into detail of the processes and get the best optimum price or optimum solution for that particular problem or particular component. So that's the few changes I have done. There are a lot of things which, of course, R&D is doing in conjunction with manufacturing. So that is a separate part of it. I didn't want to go into that details, because that'll take some more time to explain about it. But during question answer session, I can definitely address those issues.
Sure. I think you raise a very valid point that it's about proactively engaging and designing to value in a very collaborative manner. So that is, I think, the essence of this. And I think supply chain is best place to do it, because we are the ones who literally bring the product to the market, right? So converting that concept into reality in very close collaboration with R&D, commercial, what they want and how can we design it to one, an optimum level, and then in a sustainable manner. Fine.
I think the one of the, and all organizations, including organizations which I've been part of, we've typically done it in silos, right? So, there's a lot of work which happens, say, for example, on the material side, or there's a lot of work which happens on the manufacturing side. However, the need really is to say that in this age, and, use what Rajiv mentioned about the whole digitized supply chain. It's a very good buzzword, but frankly, what does that mean, right? And the whole part is that how, right from the customer, including distribution, manufacturing, procurement, all the way to the supplier, right? How do all these groups really work as one, right? Today, the point will always be, in the terms of looking at whether I look at a sort of a global optima versus a very local optima, in the sense that I do my part very well, right? And we lend it to the others. I think where organizations, I don't say that we've succeeded, but I think the steps really towards that are saying, how do we do a whole, what I call an integrated planning piece, right? And there will be technologies on various aspects of it. So if I look at it and I start from the consumer, right? If I look at it from a forecast or a demand point of view, right? Our view of demand, really had always been very static, right? Like we talked about, month-end SKUs. What was the idea? It was basically saying that, I'm given a number, I somehow have to meet that target by the end of the month, right? I think the whole part is slowly changing in forecasting when we talk of terms like using AI or using machine learning. I think the important part is to say, where do I see demand? And is demand a number or is it some sort of what I could call a probability, right? Do I do 100 with an 80% probability, right? Or do I do an 80 with 100% probability? And I think the need to understand that and the need to build that is the fact that things will not be static. So the minute my demand changes, right? How does the rest of the supply chain, right? How does it get geared to manage that, right? So today we say, for example, I have markets where I do 50% of my sale in the last 5 days, right? The question is really using data to understand, saying that what's the trends in this market, right? And today you found the front-end teams also being willing to look at it. In the sense they say that typically if I do a 70% by the 20th or the 22nd or the 25th, I think I will be able to do this number, right? And what's the difference between what is the past and what we are looking at? At the past, it was gut. It was a question of calling up the guy and say, "Acha number hone wala hai," right? And that's what it was. I think the big part is using that data to say how, what's the probability of that number happening? And there are models today which people have agreed and said, yes, if this is the past history, and I see I have only done 50%. I don't think I have a hope in hell of doing it, right? That helps control parts in terms of service and more importantly, inventory. What do I make the right things or do I blindly make according to a plan? The second area which I would talk about, and that's something which, all of us in supply chain possibly hate doing, right? Someone comes and says, okay, what are the scenarios, right? And that the typical thought we all have is that, that's going to be another night out that we're going to have in terms of building up 5 scenarios, right? Today, and scenarios could be absolutely at different parts of the chain, right? It could be from a demand side. It could be a demand side in terms of demand going up or down because of a pricing decision, a regulatory decision, right? How does that impact the rest of the chain? And do I get information at the right time to be able to act on it, right? The other end, if I look at the back end, today, for example, if there's going to be a problem for me in terms of availability of my key raw material in a certain plant, or if I talk about, say, a plant line going down because I'm seeing preventive maintenance giving me a signal saying that something is not right, right? Do I then need to wait for the problem to happen or the issue to happen before I react? And I think that's where technology helps, right? Today, for example, and again, just take some of the buzzwords. You talk of an IoT, right? In, for preventive maintenance in manufacturing, etc. The point is, do I really use the information I get to be able to predict what will happen, right? If today that signal is telling me that this machine is possibly going to go down, right? And it's possibly going to be a week from now, how do I then react to say that what are going to be the what-if scenarios in advance? I don't wait for the problem to happen, right? I think that's where technology really comes in. Now, it's not that these things have not been done before. I mean, we've always built scenarios, we do BCPs, etc., right? But the point is, do I do it in an integrated fashion? And that's where the layer of having an integrated planning function, which really looks at both sides. And when I look at plan, right, I typically say you neither sell, you neither make, you neither buy, right? But the point is, you are the person who's going to orchestrate this whole piece. You hold it together. You hold that tension on both sides, both from the demand side as well as from the supply side. I think that's a key part of what we do. I think the other, some of the other areas which I would say is that if I look at now logistics, right, as part of this chain. Now today what happens is that most of the processes till now had been very manual. If I look at most warehouses, and I would dare enough say that 75 to 80% of warehouses in India are, still manual, right? How do I change that to being automated And again, automated, not for the sake of automation, to be passing on that information. If today, when I looked at capacity, I always looked at capacity and said manufacturing capacity. What we discovered, and we discovered to a peril in the last 1 year, is where we struggled the most was dispatch. Right? Again, how does that input come in till I look at a very integrated piece, not just one piece of it. The last part which I really wanted to cover is the part on the whole thing on KPIs and dashboards. Again, we've done it from time immemorial, right? The question again is that how does that translate right across? Now, do I have a set of KPIs which actually work in conjunction, whether it is to do with front-end sales, whether it is to do with distribution, whether it's to do with manufacturing, whether it's to do with procurement, right? Along with that, add on what's there for your customer, what's there at your supplier, right? Do we know what are the impacts of each one of the KPIs by actions which happen upstream, right? Today we don't. Today we work in our silos, but that's what we're slowly moving towards. Today, an information of saying there's a problem gets transmitted very, very fast, right? The question is, today you still use a phone. Tomorrow, can it be your computer telling you there's something going wrong there?
So I think you raise a very valid point. It's about, see, there's no dearth of data. And then it's cliched, but data gets converted into information, right? And then to convert that information into knowledge, today all that's being done by systems. And I think that's a, you know, that's the evolution we've come to. The key thing is that knowledge is still being relayed to us by a system or a computer. How do we layer that with human intelligence? And that's where we come into the picture, right? How do we layer that with human intelligence and make decisions which are ahead in time rather than, you know, we do a postmortem later? So I think this is a very, very good perspective. I'll now switch gears. I'll move to Pramod. Pramod has varied experience, you know, in Siemens, and he's currently handling export, import, customs. So what I want to ask you is more from, given that, you know, we're talking about globalization, and then that's, you know, the supply chain mantra now, we need to be ready for the future. What, from your perspective, you see as the key risks for a futuristic supply chain, especially when it needs to manage, you know, the organization's expectations of a, you know, of a global customer-oriented supply chain. So what do you see are the major risks and how can we mitigate those?
So thank you. Am I audible? Yeah. So what happened is that any supply chain has got risk. The global supply chain has got definitely a more risk. Maybe these risks were existing earlier also, but today their magnitude is changing drastically. The speed at which these risks are increasing, they are really increasing, and unless you build that into your strategy, you will face a real serious challenge. So I will try to cover only four main points, and the first point is the regulations. Regulations are changing very fast, and you can see that today the relation of trade between USA and China is handled through Twitter. So people are really looking at, okay, what is going to be duty tomorrow? So you will see that the economy is handled through Twitter. Your regulations are changing so fast. What will be the anti-dumping duty or what will be the right duty tomorrow, you don't know. So if you plan something based on existing, you always carry risk that what is going to go tomorrow. Then other than the duty or anti-dumping duty, you have non-tariff barriers which are coming. Every country wants to protect their industry, and we are looking at non-tariff barrier increasing, and it's so drastically changing. Maybe people will know 1 month back, India added 284 items which are iron and steel item into not exactly non-tariff barrier, but it is told that if you are importing these 284 items, then you have to register on the DGFT website. Not before 60 days, but 15 days before imports will land. If you don't register and get certificate number, this certificate number is to be added into your bill of entry, till otherwise you cannot clear that. And if you don't have certificate and you get the material, what are you going to do? I don't know, really. So this regulation, the phytosanitary requirements, the Brazil, which is supposed to be similar like India in implementing the rules regulation, they are enforcing packing regulation to such an extent that they have sent close to 400 containers of various exporters back to the JNPT. Why? Because some packing was not treated, or there was no right certificate, or only part of packing was not. So these regulatory changes are really affecting the today's trade. Second, which is the political. I think the politics is taking over the economics and the trade. So you see that changes. But not only Trump or USA or China, you may be aware a few years back, the Middle East, 9 countries decided that they will boycott the Qatar. And then Qatar, what was moving through Qatar, what was the Qatar airline, everybody got affected. So such political, India one day decided that they will not take from Pakistan higher duties. So all that things is a political which is really affecting us. The third thing is technology. So even though you have a wish that I am technology oriented, if you are exporting to, let's say, to US or Germany, you need a different type of this thing. Maybe people, your customer is insisting on e-airway bill or invoices are going through EDI. But if your customers are in Africa, then it is becoming more problem as how to you will mitigate not only papers, but how you will mitigate the risk. So a lot of things and technology, what you are planning. So you need to have all variety to when you are handling that. And how fast you will handle that is also a challenge, that every time you will see that something changing, you will have some glitches into technology because it is getting implemented. Typically, if you look at India, they have made very nice that, okay, licenses will be digital. But if license don't get transmitted, then you spend weeks actually resolving that. So technology, you need to have really right and how you will back up. And last, the challenge which is facing is a global calamity because of environment. You will find where there is earthquake in Japan, your supply chain get affected. If there is flood in Thailand, your supply chain get affected. If there is flood in Chennai, it gets affected. If it rains for 2 hours, in your air cargo complex will get flooded. So this is another challenge which you will find, that these calamities or natural disaster is really affecting the supply chain. So I will cover with only these 4 important points, which are the risks, and they are increasing day by day. It is becoming more complex. So your VUCA plus disruption is really making the things much more worse.
Yeah, I think there's no end to it. We cannot wish these things away, right? It is not about sustainability. Global, we say that, you know, because of global warming, there are environmental damages. But whatever is there, these things are, we've seen that there's an increased, these things are happening again and again. The trade barriers, as you said, the government's protectionism will always be there. It's been there, it got, you know, subdued because there was a wave of globalization. Now there's again a wave of protectionism. I think it will change with the change in ideologies. And I think how it can be managed is only by, you know, by admitting that these things will be there, and somehow we need to bring this into our planning process. We've talked about agility. How can we proactively build some of these? You cannot have a solution for all of these, but at least as long as we are proactive, conscious that no matter what we do, we cannot insulate ourselves from it. Just being conscious about it, having a seamless communication flow, I think can at least help us move in the right direction. So thanks for that perspective. I'll switch to Ramakrishnan. Ramakrishnan is from HPCL, and I think the number of lives that they touch through their products, petroleum products, is I think all of us, are impacted that way. And he heads a very interesting function there. It's about margin improvement. So how do you improve margin in a product like petroleum? So that's it was very interesting when I was discussing with him earlier. So what I want to understand from him, one is, my basic question was, cliche, integrate to accumulate. One, how can that help supply chain? The other is also, please throw some light on what you're doing and how you're enabling this in a sector which is as unique as yours.
Yeah, good afternoon. It's a good opportunity for me to be here. As you know, HPCL, it's a third largest oil company. So the integration of a company at the level of HPCL is a very, very big challenge. See, in integration, before you bring technology, first one is the process has to be put in place. Otherwise, if you don't have a process, then you will not know how to implement the technology itself. See, the challenge I will just share in few minutes. We have 10 strategic business units, 2 joint venture refineries and 16 joint venture companies. Now each of these business units are quite large. Like if you take retail business unit, it is fueling 7 million customers a day and selling 90 million liters per day. If you take LPG, it is actually around 1.3 million cylinders are delivered in a day, and the total customer base is 81 million. So like that, there is an industry and fuel SBU is there. There is an aviation SBU, which is again doing almost around 60 flights per day. So each one, then there are refineries who are producing, one refineries. Each one has got their set of KPIs, their identifying bottlenecks, their optimization. But when it comes in the real life, what happens is the KPIs of each group, they are not in sync always. So if one group is doing well, it can be an issue for other group. I'll just tell you, for example, if you take a refinery, the refinery is producing, you know, certain low volume, high margin products. But if you look at from the refinery perspective, those products are having very low GRMs. So refinery would like to feel that, you know, I don't want to manufacture these products. Whereas when it comes to marketing, like something, it has got huge margin, volume is low, but they are highly profitable products. So marketing looks for not to discontinue these products. So what happens is there are a lot of, you know, in that process, the overall goal, no, that gets impacted. So around 5-6 years before, HPCL thought of, you know, we should go for a structured way of integrating. So a group was formed called Integrated Margin Management. The bottom line of the group is plan, enhance and deliver superior net corporate realization. That's it. That's the mandate. You plan, enhance and deliver superior net corporate realization, that is margin across the company. So from there we started. So it has been a real challenge. But the interestingly, when you see every SBU looks at what is their bottlenecks, what are their challenges, and they try and do. But the bottlenecks which are lying in between two SBUs, like if something in between the interface of marketing and refining, or interface of crude sourcing and refining, or the logistics group versus marketing, the interfacing bottlenecks are of high value and they are really frustrating bottlenecks. So what we have done is we have identified those bottlenecks in a structured manner, brought it up through a structured top management committee, which meets every month, and then we presented, got brainstorming across the top management, and then identified solutions for each of this. And that has really brought a lot of value, because that is what is normally goes unnoticed, wherein the project is implemented by one SBU, the benefit goes to other SBU. So naturally the implementing SBU is not interested. So this is where we brought it, these things, in a structured manner to a top management group, which meets every month, and then we present it. So these are all the things. And second one is the KPIs. We started doing what should be the KPI across the corporation from the margin perspective. And then we align all the groups to those KPIs, which really does a lot of turnaround. Now that, you know, we have really consolidated in the past 5 years. So when we started this exercise in 2013-14, this group, Integrated Management, Margin Management was group. This group is reporting to directly the CEO. So it's fully empowered group. They have got visibility across the company. Otherwise, one SBU doesn't share with the other SBU, whereas we have got visibility across the company. And the profit of HPCL, which was 1,800 crores in 2013-14, touched 6,000 crores in 3 years. And last 3 years, we are consistently doing 6,000 crore plus, and we wish to do more. So setting up the process, in my opinion, is the most critical thing. And once you set up the process, now you can look for what kind of technologies we require, because now we have seen the integrated planning from crude to customer, which is handled by a group. Now we will be in a better situation to see what kind of technologies we need to take and how to implement it. So I thought this is the
Thanks for that. I think the statistics were really mind-boggling in terms of the lives you touch on a daily basis. And as you rightly mentioned, and you know, we've heard this everywhere, that you know, a plan is just a plan unless it's backed up by immaculate execution. So what you really need to do is you really need to first have a process, which is nothing but a concept, till you really implement it, drive it, and then monitor it. I think that this is a perfect example of that happening. And eventually, obviously, what the profit is generated that goes on to make it more competitive and then eventually drive business growth. So thanks for giving us that perspective. I'll now switch on to Saurabh. Saurabh is with Lava International. Clearly, you know, something. So he's got very close connect with, you know, the customer and the consumer, I guess. So what I really want to understand with him is that since you're very close, I think in a market which is like yours, and you know, it's evolving at a very speedy pace, how does an integrated supply chain strategy, what are the key attributes which are required for it to become integral to the business strategy? How can they, you know, collaborate, and how can they enable each other?
Sure. Thank you, Rajiv. I'm audible, right?
Yeah.
So before coming to the attributes per se which are required for making supply chain integrated into the overall strategy of any organization, so let me explain what is actually happens in most of the organization as such which fail to deliver. So generally supply chain keeps on balancing the two aspects. One is on the speed side, other is on the cost side. So either we are talking about the service level or about the cost. If it's the good run, then we are talking about enhancing the service levels, faster deliveries. On the other end, at the bad times, probably we are talking about curtailing the cost. And then, or probably it's a balance of both that companies keep on doing. And it has been happening for decades. Somehow, these two in itself are not sufficient in terms of making a supply chain an integrated function. Otherwise, with these two criteria alone, probably it's more of a support function, I would say, which probably an SNOP meeting happens, the sales team says we can do 3 lakh units of this piece. Product team says it's 2 lakh units. Supply chain says, theek hai, 2.5 lakhs laga lete hain, kar lenge. So it's more like a support function approach where probably keep on balancing the two things. So more so, now probably when I talk about the integrated supply chain, so then the attributes, I think most of the attributes are covered by the panel, like who spoke before me on various aspects. So I put that into a framework which I call AAAIC, and probably I would take certain examples which you people have quoted here. So AAA supply chain, I think most of us have heard. So probably it was coined in Harvard some 20 years back, which talks about 3 key pillars of a successful supply chain: agility, adaptability, and alignment. So again, 15-20 years hence, I couldn't find a better framework, so I have added an I and C to it. So I will come to it. So probably on the, I think there has to be, I mean, companies need to have an agile supply chain. So we talk about the global scenarios in terms of how probably the US thing might disrupt, politics disrupting, overruling the economics as such. So let me take an example from my company recently, where probably we all need these stocks for the Diwali, and the Hong Kong is completely stuck. It happens every year. This year it's even more serious because of the disruptions, political disruptions in Hong Kong. So now how agile is the supply chain of any function which can probably act swiftly to it so that we end up having a good Diwali? So some things probably that helped us were probably having certain premium tie-ups in place in advance, probably having certain agreements with vendors where probably they can break the load and send it in smaller loads. So larger, in such times, generally larger loads get off the charters, and then they are there for 1 or 2 days more, and then your production supplies get delays. So having those in place, probably seeing how supplies can come directly from China to India instead of routing through Hong Kong. So if any company has these things or some of these more things in place at the first go in advance, probably you are prepared in terms of facing this situation. Else it's a delay that probably will only lead to losing sales. Coming to adaptability again, it's more on the business. So agility was more on the demand and supply gaps as such, which is far more common these days with so many external scenarios around. Adaptability is completely changing the business model per se. So a Sino-US trade war happening, China per capita increasing at a fast pace, making it probably saturation coming in. Vietnam, again with a smaller population per capita, will rise so soon. So probably can someone see that India is the next place? Many companies, many organizations globally are seeing that and moving to India. So then, and if their supply chains are functioning in tandem with the business strategy to move their supply chains to India, then probably those are the adaptable supply chains they will win here in times to come. Again, alignment, the third A, which I say, I say it from the need of the partners or from the intermediary companies, as you were saying, in terms of, is there an alignment on overall goal in terms of getting the bigger margins? So if that alignment is there, so then probably I would say that again, end-to-end control on the value chain, and then everyone seeing the same picture at the same time, be it the other, be it the JVs or the companies within the organization, or probably the vendors. Are we aligning our vendors to the supply financing solutions? Are we making them more capable, moving them from a VMI model so to a financing model where probably they can be a partner in the business rather than a vendor? So that probably I will say in alignment. So these three are the core pillars which I see are the key attributes when we talk about a successful integrated supply chain. But in today's scenario, I would probably put an I and C to it. I is the infrastructure. So I don't mean the brick and mortar infrastructure. When I say this, I talk, I'm coming more from the technology side, which you were covering, Krishna, in terms of be it the AI or the IoT things that we are talking about, or per se, it might be very basic things wherein there is an end-to-end visibility across the entire platform in terms of the transporter portals, vendor portals, WMS, and all those things. If we are not building up our supply chain on the technology front, then probably we are not preparing ourselves for the future. And so, infrastructure is the base on the technology side. On these, I say that these three pillars are standing. And the biggest thing in today's scenario, which is superimposing all these attributes, is the need of consumer centricity. More so, that is important right now with the advent of the e-commerce and the kind of expectations that customers are having right now, be it in the B2B segment or say B2C segment. So consumer is no longer a petitioner now. Earlier, he used to be a petitioner. It's okay. I mean, you deliver in 7 days, it's okay. It's as long as it's coming on time within a certain cost, it's okay. Now he is demanding. There's not a monopoly. If you are not able to supply, there's someone else who is committing a same day delivery or probably some fixed hour delivery also. And that consumer is ready to pay that cost. So that is one part in terms of the service level where we need to think of the consumer centricity. Second, also in terms of leveraging on the brand from creating levers on consumer centricity. So I believe that the brand ambassador of any company is not Ranbir Kapoor or Mahendra Singh Dhoni or Sachin Tendulkar. It's the last mile delivery guy who is going and delivering to that consumer in terms of how he is speaking to them. So I don't think that currently there is focus in India or elsewhere in terms of training those people in terms of how to deal with a consumer, how many times to call them, how to greet them. So that is, I think, one of the biggest gap, at least on the B2C last mile side, which companies can work on in terms of creating that consumer centricity and take a good leverage on the brand front. So this is how I would like to sum up like whatever we are discussing so far and probably putting it into a framework.
See, I totally agree with you. The three A's that you talked about, even 20 years later, they will always be,
they were
present.
Years ago, someone coined them just
because back. You cannot have a supply chain that's neither agile nor aligned, and then we lose the purpose, right? It's about those are the core pillars, and then how do we layer that with, what is the reality of today, which is, as you said, it's infrastructure, IT, and then the customer centricity. I'll go to Sudhir. Sudhir's he's a VP with Pfizer. Worked in automobile and now with pharma. Building on what he talked about attributes, how do you see the you know, the integrated supply chain delivering value, and your thoughts on it. What do you want to share about, you know, the topic?
Yeah, surely, you know, I have actually been benefited by several views that we have received. I mean, getting it, and in fact, like sort of what he said, you know, we should be very close to customer. It's not as a matter of fact, like what we used to have is, you know, marketing has given this demand, marketing is not lifting this material, and therefore the forecast accuracy is 70% or 80% or 60% or something of that kind of phenomenon that we used to have. And the management will be completely endorsing, yes, since marketing has not given, so how can you make it? But now the point is, unless until they will be giving, we are making it, that is something which required to be, you know, expected from the supply chain. So 80% forecast accuracy is true, but 20% is something which you have to take it out from horse's mouth. And this horse's mouth is basically the consumer, the customer. And that is, he may not be wrong at any point of time. And that is why, you know, and another word, his point is basically the last mile delivery. Earlier, it used to be like when we started our career almost more than two decades back, we found that the total gambit of supply chain used to be planning to dispatch. But now it has actually spread out, you know, from planning, or rather I should say order forecasting, to planning to dispatch to last mile delivery. And wherever, you know, we used to have 90 plus kind of service level, but now what we can see, like even in case of, you know, this kind of big billion sales which is going on, and even when the volume for Amazon or Flipkart is increased multifold during these 4 or 5 days, but I really amazed to see, and this is my personal experience, if I ordered 7 o'clock in the evening and the guy is at the doorstep in the next morning 6 o'clock, I mean, that is the kind of, you know, so, you know, people are doing now based upon not 90 plus, but 99.91 or 92, I mean the last decimal place, you know, that is the kind of accuracy that we are looking at. And frankly speaking, like if I look at pharma and then compare to automobile, where I spent a lot of time, it used to be very, very efficient supply chain, especially in automobile sector. But I should say, I mean, e-commerce is something which is, you know, topping the chart. And the major reason is that they would have to, you know, if even they will be using, say, AI technology or IoT technology or machine learning on those kind of things, sometime they would also get it converted. I mean, these are the technology which will be giving you some kind of alert. You know, you have to prepare for this because this is something which is going to happen. I mean, Diwali festival is coming, and therefore the, you know, the sale of cars, the sale of white goods is going to increase. So these are the kind of, you know, alerts which is being given. Now, the point is, how do you convert it? How do you execute it? And therefore, when we say integration, there are two aspects of integration. One is supply chain. So order for forecasting to planning to ordering of material, getting from suppliers, you know, putting it in the warehouse, giving it to assembly or manufacturing line, and then dispatching it and supplying it. That is, you know, end-to-end integration as far as the supply chain is concerned. But another aspect which is very important is that how supply chain is integrating with business, how supply chain is integrating with manufacturing, how supply chain is integrating with, you know, the local factor, the social. You know, these are the areas which will be fulfilling the remaining 20% of forecast accuracy, because that is giving you an idea as to what are going to change. So forecast accuracy during the S&OP meeting that takes place traditionally for years together will be giving you an idea. But what you need to do is to, you know, you will be chatting sometime. I mean, S&OP meeting is a formal, you know, monthly meeting or maybe a review meeting on weekly basis. That will be giving, you know, sometime the commercial is actually negotiating in some kind of tender. I'm talking about pharmaceutical, for instance. That tender is not going to be completed when the S&OP meetings happen. Now, what they are going to give a forecast? Definitely not. But at the same time, for the company, the organization perspective, this tender is very important, which will be giving you a lot of leverage in terms of capturing the major market share or in terms of profitability or something like that. Now the role of supply chain manager is actually beyond the, you know, standard operating process. Like what my colleague from HPCL said, like process is very important, but at the same time, hearsay and insight, what have been discussed in the marketing, you know, conference room is something you will be preparing in advance within your jurisdiction. For example, some ingredients in some product of pharmaceutical are very common. Once you find that this deal is going to be executed in next 1 month or 2 months, you will be buying some material in advance, keeping in a stock. And the moment it will be finalized, then you will be getting it made. And therefore, that lead time, which otherwise used to be a month or 1.5 months, will reduce to just a couple of weeks. That is, you know, very important, like you will be integrating with the business. So, I mean, sometimes we say, manufacturing is not able to do it because of some labor issue or maybe some breakdown issue or something like that. But that is where the supply chain need to integrate with them in terms of when they are going to go for preventive maintenance. And that preventive maintenance can be preponed or postponed considering the, you know, the fertile period for the commercial. Those integration is, and therefore they will be talking on behalf of manufacturing with the engineering section who is going to execute all these maintenance. So, I mean, that is something, you know, we have been given a showcase from, you know, direct to customer kind of companies, essentially e-commerce or essentially, you know, those like mobile companies or FMCG. And that is something which we have to use it for, you know, the heavy industries or medium industries in order to capitalize.
So thanks to the, you've given perspective on different industries which I think are true to the current context. So thanks for it.
I just wanted to add one more thing, you know, as you said, it depends on the industry to industry also. Like, for example, I wanted to give two companies, you know, example in case of Hyundai and Maruti. Over there, the supplies, incoming supply from suppliers, so planned that Maruti will refuse to check material if the truck of the supplier will be reaching 15 minutes early or 15 minutes late. I mean, that is the kind of accuracy because they are not able to cope up with their warehouses because the space is limited. And secondly, the supplier will not be tuned based upon the just-in-time kind of phenomenon. But that aspect will be different to, say, pharma or consumer goods or something like that.
So thanks for it. I'm very conscious of time. I want to have some time for the audience as well. Nidish, very thanks for waiting very patiently for your turn. So Nidish is with Mahindra, and Mahindra manages outbound logistics. So clearly, we have, you know, a different perspective from another part of the industry. Coming back to our main theme, which is about, you know, the corporate strategy, how do you think supply chain can engage and, you know, provide our learnings and insights so that we are able to enable commercial, both enable them and influence them, and, you know, with our learning, so that, you know, we have an equal role to play in designing the corporate strategy. Your views on that?
Surely. See, supply chain encompasses the end-to-end flow of information, products and money. That's why it is very important the supply chain has a proper alignment with the corporate strategy, because supply chain can directly affect all the commercial decisions, be it the credit policies, be it the availability of products, be it in terms of a serviceability to the customers. It can also influence how you are going to have what kind of a credit lines you have to issue, how is the product size. Now let's look into today's scenario, wherein more and more rural sales are picking up. And when we consider the rural sales, the rural market has a very different requirements compared to the urban segments. Rural is going for last 10 years, is it going in double digit. When we look at the rural, the pack size are different, which we need to service. The concentration is much lesser in compared to urban segments. So these supply chain decisions, where do we manufacture these products? Where are we going to distribute these products? Where the distribution networks? what is the kind of a logistic solutions we are going to work. Maybe we have to look into more and more collaborative supply chains, because it may not be cost competitive if we try to address these supply chains standalone, because the volumes may not justify the geography spread. So we need to serve a spread on a cost competitive manner. So it becomes very important for supply chain, for an organization competitive perspective, that supply chain address these issues. So particularly if you look at today, the kind of a cost block in supply chain is one of the largest cost component in any organization, more than even the capital cost, which is engaged into the working capital, machines and all that. So how do you manage your supply chains can make a big difference to your organization competitiveness. So I think as far as influence is concerned, it is very simple. In terms of how are you communicating your decisions in terms of manufacturing, in terms of product distribution, in terms of reach, in terms of product portfolios, all these decisions can be very well attributed, which can be supply chain handled. I think
the key is communication, right? Your learnings, your insights, what are potential, you know, as Pramod had alluded to earlier, what are the risks that you foresee?
Yes.
I think having a clear line of communication is the best way, and then obviously you can, you know, look at various aspects to it. So thanks for that. We do have 6 minutes left. I think all of us have shared our views on the topic, so I will not go through it. I will now open this to the audience. We have 6 minutes on the timer, so please make best use of it. If there are any burning questions which we are not able to answer, you can please catch us after the session as well. So, but the floor is open. I'd like to have your name and then the question. Go ahead. Can we have the mic, please?
My name is Sandeep Trivedi. So basically, the question was more in terms of, see, like in manufacturing, there came a time where, you know, we had to decide what's our core competence and the rest was actually outsourced, right? So how does a company decide what's that sweet spot where you start outsourcing some of your supply chain activity? It could be people, process, technology, or a combination. So that was the first question. Second was more about, of course, integrated supply chain is easier said than done. We all know that. So if there are any examples of how you use some collaborative ideas, the point was made about collaboration, where, you know, you try to leverage the shared capacity and capability of either your peers or your collaborators or your partners or any of the other, because in a way supply chain is more like a road network which is across the country. So obviously you have only so much capacity available, and in Mumbai I think we know better than anyone else what I mean, right? So I'm looking for any specific examples from the entire panel if they have. So one is more on the outsourcing piece, and second is on in terms of the actual collaboration that helped you save money, time and all the resources that the company is trying to save. Thank you.
I can answer on the collaboration part. Like earlier, in one of the panel, there was a CGM from IOC was there. See, the product of petrol and diesel, you know, they are meeting BIS spec, and there is nothing, there is no special branding or anything in that. So what happens is there are 20 refineries in the country, which refinery belongs to different companies, and there are different pipelines are there. Now we actually have a collaborative discussions with them, wherein if let's say HPCL has got product in Vizag and there is a pipeline going from Vizag to Hyderabad, or Indian Oil has got a refinery at Chennai and they have got a pipeline from Chennai to Trichy or Madurai. Now if I have to move product to meet the demand of Tamil Nadu from Vizag, I spend hell of a money. So now he has to move product from Tamil Nadu to Andhra and Telangana, he has to spend money. So we have a arrangement of, you know, ton-to-ton exchange. Like you purchase from me here, equivalent quantity I will purchase from you there. So using the other oil company as one of my mode of transport. So I am transporting indirectly from Vizag to Tamil Nadu through Indian Oil. So in that process, what happens is, number one is, when I am as a receiver, my cost is coming down, because I am not transporting the product there. At the same time, when as a giver,
my infrastructure is used better because he is using, but I am selling to him from the pipeline terminals. So my pipeline capacity goes up. Otherwise, if I am putting the pipeline using only for HPCL, let's say it is operating at 40%, when I am trying to arrange with the other oil companies, my capacity goes up to 80-90%. So I am benefiting while giving and benefiting while taking. And since overall it is on ton-to-ton exchange, so we don't try to hit each other. That's an example for collaboration.
So, shall I answer that?
Go ahead, but very quickly, because I like to maybe take one.
Incidentally, morning only I had a meeting with one of our contract manufacturer actually. So we, as you know, we are into air conditioners, plus we make the freezers also. The freezers, the commercial freezers where we store the ice cream and the bottle coolers and the beer and all actually. So we have our own manufacturing plant where we manufacture freezers, but here there's one more guy who wants to set up a manufacturing facility for making freezers. So we had a discussion, we said, okay, we have a capacity, we have technology, you have setting up a plant. So what we realized, because as I earlier said that we also make that, discuss with the manufacturing, make a make versus buy decisions together actually. So what we found that would be very difficult for us to compete in the market if we try to make the smaller ones. In the sense that freezers, to give you briefly idea about the product line, we have starting with 60 liters, 100 liters, 150, 250, goes up to 700 liters. So what we said that probably we should use our capacity and the capability for manufacturing the bigger size, say 300 to 700 liters, and 60 to 250 liters we will outsource from you. So we will have the capacity utilization well for both the manufacturing plants, mine own and there. At the same time, we will be competitive because we know bigger companies typically would have a bigger overhead when a smaller company would have a smaller, less overhead. So we found that if we try to make a smaller one, we may not be competitive actually. So that's how one of the examples, since you wanted to know, so I'll share that example.
But you mentioned very rightly, it's about finding the sweet spot, right?
Yeah.
And see, I had contract manufacturing for for GSK's paint category brands. Let me just tell you, I'll not name the company, but we source from a global MNC in Vietnam, and we are suppliers to them in Europe. Right, this is about, and ultimately a consumer is taking, and these are competitive products. Same product, same formulation, different brands. It's about, understanding that customer will buy what they want to buy. How can we as supply chain collaborate and give them what they want? There are conflicts of interest, competitive pressures there, but then it's ultimately finding that sweet spot. And there are many examples like that.
I think the other point which you talked about, the outsourcing, right? And I think the answer is, once you map out your complete process, I think the important thing is to say what is an action which is repetitive, which I can hand over, right? Where is it that I have, for the lack of a better word, an IP behind it, right? And I think that's the broad, picture of saying, what do I outsource with, what do I keep, right? It could be, and let me take an example in the supply chain, right? So, different industry, for example, FMCGs, they might outsource manufacturing, right? There's no technology to it. But there will be very few, for example, an automobile company, for example, who actually use lines across, right? Because that's the core idea, anyone can make a soap, for example, right? But the bigger part today is not going to be silos in this, right? Outsourcing could be, and I'm saying one of the things which a lot of companies do very well, and companies in-house don't do as well, is look at this whole thing of a control tower, right? Because someone's actually able to look at that chain from that distance and say what works, what doesn't work, right? The minute you are sitting there doing something, right, chances are very high you're not going to question yourself, right? So I think those are the sort of broad principles that you use when you decide to outsource.
Absolutely. Thanks, Rishan. We are over time now. So if you have any burning questions, please, you can always, we are here till, late evening. So please feel free to reach out and ask us. I'd like to thank the esteemed panel. It's been a learning experience for me as well. I mean, I heard a lot of things and I've personally gained from it, and I hope it's been useful to you as well. So thanks for, your participation, and really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. We want to say a big thank you to all our panelists, our moderators, so many different industry perspectives when it comes to emerging trends and challenges in supply chain. So thank you very, very much. We've got our beautiful mementos, and we're going to request our moderator to do us the honors. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rajeev Manmani, presenting a memento to our very first panelist, Mr. Saurabh Raghuvanshi. Thank you very much for joining us. We'd also like to say thank you to Mr. Pramod Sant from Siemens Limited India. Thank you, Mr. Sudhir Mohan Bansal from Pfizer Limited. A big thank you to Mr. D.H. Roy from Blue Star. Thank you. We'd also like to thank Mr. Alok Kedia from IndusInd Bank Limited. Thank you very much for your presence here this afternoon. With us, contributing on our panel, Mr. Ramakrishnan Subramanian from Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited. Mr. Hariharan Krishnan from Diageo India Private Limited. And of course, sing a big thank you to Mr. Nidish Kuchal from Mahindra and Mahindra Limited. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to say thank you to our moderator. Ladies and gentlemen, with a loud round of applause, we'd like to thank him, and we request Mr. Saurabh Raghuvanshi to do us the honors. Mr. Saurabh Raghuvanshi from Lava International, presenting a plaque on behalf of all of us to our moderator, Mr. Rajiv Manwani. Well, ladies and gentlemen, for our panelists, our moderator, as they get together for a group photograph, a little closer, please, gentlemen. Our panel sends out energy to you all as well for being a fantastic audience. Thank you so much.